powerful, the wisest country in the world, has taken a high degree at Girton and is on her way home again, having achieved a complete mastery over all the elements that have tended to raise that glorious country to its present preeminent position among civilized nations.
Oh, then in a few months, Utopia may hope to be completely anglicized.
Absolutely, and without a doubt.
We are very well as we are. Life without a care, our every want supplied by a kind and fatherly monarch who, despot though he be, has no other thought but to make his people happy. What have we to gain by the great change which is in store for us?
What have we to gain? English institutions. English tastes. And oh, English fashion.
England has made herself what she is because in that favored land, everyone must think for himself. Here, we have no need to think, because our monarch anticipates all our wants. And our political opinions are formed for us by the journals to which we subscribe. Oh, think how much more brilliant this dialogue would have been if we had been accustomed to exercise our reflective powers. They say that in England, the conversation of the very meanest is a coruscation of impromptu epigram.
Exploder, I am next in succession to the throne. I nevertheless do my best to fall in with the royal decree. But when I am overmastered with an indignant sense of overwhelming wrong, as I am now, I slip into my native tongue without realizing it. I am told that in the language of that great and pure nation, strong expressions do not exist. Consequently, when I want to let off steam, I have no alternative but to say, la 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 la.
But what is your grievance?
This. By our constitution, we are governed by a despot, who, although in theory absolute, is in practice nothing of the kind, being watched day and night by two wise men, whose duty it is, on his very first lapse from political or social propriety, to denounce him to me, the public exploder. It then becomes my duty to blow up his majesty with dynamite. Thank you. And as some compensation to my wounded feelings, I reign in his stead.
Yes, after many unhappy experiments in the direction of an ideal republic, it was found that what may best be described as despotism, tempered by dynamite, provides, on the whole, the most satisfactory description of ruler. An autocrat who dares not abuse his autocratic power.
Yes, that's the theory, but in practice, how does it work? Now, do you ever happen to see the Palace Peeper?
Palace Peeper?
Never even heard of the journal.
It does not surprise me. His Majesty's agents all spy up the whole edition. But I have an aunt in the publishing department, and she has supplied me with a copy. Well, it actually teems with circumstantially convincing details of His Majesty's abominable immoralities.
Oh!
Why, if this high-class journal is to be believed, His Majesty is one of the most helicobalian publicans that ever disgraced an autocratic throne. And do these wise men denounce him to me? No, not a bit of it! They wink at his immoralities. Under the circumstances, I really do believe I'm justified in saying, lalabalala, lalabalala, galabalala! I don't care. The occasion demands it.
Our duty is to spy upon our king's illicities
and keep a watchful eye on all his eccentricities.
If ever a trick he tries and savors of rascality. At our decree he dies without the least formality. We fear no rude rebuff, or newspaper publicity.
Our word is quite enough, The rest is electricity.
A pound of dynamite, explodes in his auriculars.
It's not a pleasant sight,
We'll
spare you the particulars.
It's force all men confess, Our king needs no admonishing.
We may say it's success.
Success
is something quite astonishing.
Our despot it imbues with virtues quite delectable. He minds his P's and Q's and Q's and keeps himself respectable. Of a tyrant polite,
he's a paragon quite.
He's as modest as mine,
his ways as a child.
And no one ever met with an autocrat yet.
So delightfully bland to the least in the land.
So delightfully bland to the least in the land.
So bland. So bland.
So great away the wise men, their prize men, double first to the world's university. For the lovely this island, which is my land, she has come to master the diversity.
My boy, you are not in your customary exuberant spirits. What's wrong?
Scafio, I think you once told me that you have never loved...
never. I have often marveled at the fairy influence which weaves its rosy web about the faculties of the greatest and wisest of our race. But I thank heaven that I have never been subject to its singular fascination. For, oh, Phantis, there is that within me that tells me that when my time does come, the convulsions will be tremendous. When I love, it will be with the accumulated fervor of 66 years! Ha ha! Oh, but I have an ideal. A semi-transparent being filled with an inorganic pink jelly. And I have never yet seen the woman who approaches within measurable distance of it. All are opaque. Opaque! Opaque! Keep that ideal firmly before you, and love not until you find her. Though but 55, I am an old campaigner in the battlefields of love. And believe me, it is better to be as you are, heart-free and happy, than as I am, eternally racked with doubting agonies. Oh, Scafio, the Princess Zara returns from England today.
My poor boy, I see it all.
Oh, you smile, for you have never seen her. She sailed for England 3 months before you took office.
Tell me, is your affection requited?
I do not know. I am not sure. Sometimes I think that it is. And then come these torturing doubts. Oh, I am certain that she does not regard me with absolute indifference, for she could never look at me without having to go to bed with a sick headache.
Well, that is certainly something. Come, take heart. You are young and beautiful. What more could a maiden want?
Scafio, remember, she returns from a land where every youth is as a young Greek god, and where such beauty as I can boast is seen at every turn.
Oh, be of good cheer. Marry her, my boy, if so your fancy wills, and be certain that love will come.
Then you will assist me in this?
Why, certainly. Silly one, what have you to fear? We have but to say the word, and her father must consent. Is he not our very slave? Come, take heart. I cannot bear to see you so sad.
Oh, now I may hope indeed. Scafio, you have placed me on the very pinnacle of human joy.
Let all your doubts take wing. Our influence is great. If paramount our king presume to hesitate, put on the screw and caution him that he may rue disaster grim, which must ensue to life and limb, should he poo-poo this harmless whim, this harmless whim, this harmless whim, this harmless whim, this harmless whim. It is, as I say, a harmless whim, a harmless whim. Observe this dance, which I employ, when I by chance go mad with joy. What sentiment does this express? What sentiment does this express? Supreme content and happiness. Of course it does, of course it does. Supreme content and happiness. Of course it does, of course it does. It's happiness. I thought to speak the word, and lo, the maid is mine. I do not choose to be denied, or wish to lose a lovely bride. If to refuse the king decide, the royal shoes, then woe betide.
Then woe betide,
woe betide,
woe betide,
woe betide. The royal shoes, then woe betide, then woe betide. This step to use, I condescend, whene'er I choose to serve a friend. What it implies, now try to guess. What it implies, now try to guess. Typifies unselfishness, of course it does, of course it does. It typifies unselfishness, of course it does, of course it does. Unselfishness.
Oh,
tyrannic power we, a despot whose tyrannic will is law, whose rule is paramount on land and sea, a presence of unutterable awe. But though the awe that I inspire must shrivel with imperial fire, all those whom it may chance to touch, to judge by what I see and hear, does not seem to interfere with popular enjoyment much.
No, no, it does not interfere with our enjoyment much.
Stupendous when we rouse ourselves to strike, resistless when our tyrant thunder peals. We often wonder what the obstruction's like and how a contradicted monarch feels. But though it is our royal whim, our royal sails to set and trim, to suit whatever winds may blow, what Buffett's contradiction deals, and how a thwarted monarch feels, we probably shall never know.
No, no, what thwarted monarch feels, you'll never know.
My subjects all, it is your wish emphatic that all Utopia shall henceforth be modeled upon that glorious country called Great Britain, to which some add, but others do not, Ireland.
It is!
That being so, as you insist upon it, we have arranged that our two younger daughters, who have been finished by an English lady, a grave and good and gracious English lady. shall daily be exhibited in public, that all may learn what, from the English standpoint, is looked upon as maidenly perfection. Come hither,
titles, of his titles, hints at settlements and so on. Smiling sweetly, they discreetly ask for further evidences. Thus invited, he delighted, gives the usual references. Don't forget the references. This is business, each is flattered when the offer's fairly uttered. Which of them has his affection? He declines to make selection. Do they quarrel for his dross? Not a bit of it, they toss.
Wish to speak with us, I believe. You needn't keep your crown on our account, you know.
I beg your pardon. I always forget that. Odd, the notion of a king not being allowed to wear one of his own crowns in the presence of two of his own subjects.
Yes, bizarre, is it not?
Most quaint, but then again, it's a quaint world.
Teams with quiet fun. You know, I often think what a lucky thing it is that you are blessed with such a keen sense of humor.
Do you know, I find it invaluable. Try as I will, I cannot help look at the humorous side of things. For, properly considered, everything has its humorous side. Even the palace peeper! See here. Another royal scandal by Junius Junior. Oh, how long is this to last by Cynic Senior? Ribald Royalty by Mercury Major. And where is the public exploder by Mephistopheles Minor? When I reflect that each of these outrageous attacks on my morality was written by me at your command, well, it's one of the funniest things that has come within the scope of my experience.
And besides, they have a quiet humor all of their own, which is simply irresistible.
Not bad, I think. Biting, trenchant sarcasm, the rapier, not the bludgeon. That's my line. But then it's so easy. I'm such a good subject. A bad king, but a good subject. Oh, a capital heading for next week's leading article. And then those stinging little paragraphs about our royal goings-on with our royal second housemaid. Oh, delicately sub-acid, are they not?
My dear king, and that sort of thing, no one can hold a candle to you.
Yes, but the crowning joke is King Tuppence or a good deal less than half a sovereign. Oh, it's immense.
Yes, that's what I wanted to speak with you about. Now, I've no doubt that even that has its humorous side, if one could only see it. And as a rule, I'm pretty quick at detecting latent humor. But I confess, I do not quite see where it comes in this particular case. It's so horribly personal.
Personal? Why, of course it's personal, but you have to consider the antithetical humor of the situation.
Yes, I don't think I quite grasp that.
No, you surprise me. Why consider? In person, thousands tremble at your frown. On paper, thousands roar at it.
In person, your most arbitrary pronouncements are received by your subjects with abject submission. On paper, they shout with joy at your most terrible decrees.
It's not every monarch who gets to undo, on paper, all the despotic absurdities he's committed in person, you know.
Of course. Now I see it. Thank you very much. I was sure it had its humorous side, and it was very dull of me not to have seen it. But, as you just said, it's a quaint world.
Teams with quiet fun.
Yes, properly considered, what a farce life is, to be sure.
Oh, Mephistopheles.
Oh, it's all very well. I always try to look at the humorous side of things. But I do not think I should be required to write libels against my own moral character. Naturally, I see the joke in it. Anybody would. But Zara comes home today. She's no longer a child, and, well, I confess, I should be very sorry if the palace people got into her hands. Though it's certainly very smart. Oh, very smart indeed. It's almost a pity that I have to buy up the entire edition, because it's really too good to be lost. And Lady Sophie.
Oh, that blameless type of perfect womanhood.
Good heavens. What would she think if that second housemaid business were to meet her pure blue eye?
My monarch is soliloquizing. I will withdraw.
No, pray. Don't go. Now, I'll give you 50 chances, and you'll not be able to guess whom I was thinking of.
Alas, sir, I know too well. Our king, it is an old, old story, and I well nigh weary of it. Be warned in time. From my heart I pity you, but I am not for you.
But hear what I have to say.
It is useless. Listen. In the course of a long and adventurous career in the principal European courts, it has been revealed to me that I subconsciously exercise a weird and supernatural fascination over all crowned heads. So irresistible is this singular property that there is not a European monarch who has not implored me with tears in his eyes to quit his kingdom and take my fatal charms elsewhere. As time was getting on, it occurred to me that by descending several pegs in the scale of respectability, I might qualify your majesty for my hand. Actuated by this humane motive, and happening to possess respectability enough for 6, I consented to confer respectability enough for 4 upon your 2 younger daughters. But although I have, alas, only respectability enough for 2 left, there is still, as I gather from the public press in this country, a considerable balance in my favor.
Damn. Might I ask how you came by this?
It was handed to me by the officer who holds the position of public exploder to your Imperial Majesty.
And surely, Lady Sophie, surely you are not so unjust as to put any faith in the irresponsible gabble of the society press.
I read on the authority of Senex Senior that your Majesty was seen dancing with your second housemaid on the oriental platform of the Tivoli Gardens. That is untrue.
Absolutely. Our second housemaid has only one leg.
How do you know that?
Common report. I give you my honor.
It may be so. I further read, and this statement is vouched for by no less an authority than Mephistopheles Minor,
Majesty indulges in a bath of hot rum punch every morning. I trust I do not lay myself open to the charge of displaying an indelicate curiosity as to the mysteries of the royal dressing room when I ask if there is any foundation for this statement.
None whatever. When our medical advisor exhibits rum punch, it is as a draft, not a fomentation. As to our bath, our valet plays the garden hose upon us every morning.
Oh. Oh, pray spare me these unseemly details. Well, you are a despot. Have you taken steps to slay the scribbler?
Well, no. I have not gone so far as that. After all, it's the poor devil's living, you know.
It's the poor devil's living that surprises me. If this man lies, there is no recognized punishment that is sufficiently terrible for him.
That's just it. I am waiting until a punishment is devised that will exactly meet the enormity of the case. I am in constant contact with the Mikado of Japan. Who is a recognized authority on such subjects. Moreover, I have the ground plans and sectional elevations of several capital punishments in my desk at this very moment. Oh, Lady Sophie, as you are powerful, be merciful.
Subjected to your heavenly gaze, poetical phrase, my brain is turned completely. Observe me now. No monarch I vow was ever so far afflicted.
We yell yes, but first lifeguards. On the royal yacht, when the waves were white, in a helmet hot and a tunic tight, and our great big boots, we defied the storm, for we're not recruits, and a uniform, a well-dressed trooper, ne'er discards, and we are the escort first lifeguards. The first lifeguards, the first lifeguards. And we are the escort first lifeguards.
Too severely, such shortcomings, as you may detect, in our semi-barbarous society.
Sir, I have eyes for nothing but the blameless and the beautiful.
Beautiful!
Thank you. He is really very polite. Lady Sophie, do not leave us.
Sir, your children are young and, so far, innocent. If they are to remain so, it is necessary that they be at once removed from the contamination of their present disgraceful surroundings.
Oh, dear, dear. They really shouldn't. Captain Fitzbattleaxe.
Sir?
Your troopers appear to be receiving a troublesome amount of attention from those young ladies. I know how strict you English soldiers are, and I should be very distressed if anything happened that would shock their puritanical British sensitiveness.
Oh, I don't think there's any chance of that.
You think not? They won't be offended.
Oh, no, they're quite hardened to it. They get a good deal of that sort of thing sounding sentry of the Horse Guards.
It's English.
It's particularly English.
Well, then, of course, it's all right. Pray proceed, ladies. It's particularly English. Come, my daughter, for we have much to say to each other.
Oh, farewell, Captain Fitzbattleaxe. I cannot thank you too emphatically for the devoted care with which you have watched over me during our long and eventful voyage. Ah, gallant soldier, brave and true in tented field.
chaos is due to young lifeguards and falling. Completely reconciles him to his olivand for calling. When soldier seeks Utopian glades in charge of youth and beauty, then pleasure merely masquerades as regimental duty. Until it is settled which gentleman is to blow out the brains of the other, it is provided by the rival admirer's clauses consolidation act that the young lady be entrusted to an officer of household cavalry, a stakeholder, who is then bound to hand her over to the survivor on the tontine principle in a good condition of substantial and decorative repair.
Reasonable wear and tear and damages by fire excluded.
Exactly.
Well, that seems very reasonable.
What do you say? Shall we entrust her to this officer of household cavalry? It will give us time.
Oh, I don't know. I am in no condition to think things out coolly. But if he is an officer of the household cavalry, and if the princess consents...
Alas, dear sirs, I see no alternative under the Rival Admirers Clauses Consolidation Act.
Good. That's settled. It's on us all, I think, or on that by the English custom bound, I hold the lady safe and sound in trust, for I'm a rival, until you clearly testify, by sword or pistol, by and by, this gentleman prefers to die. And which prefers survival?
It's clearly understood, around that by your English custom bound, he holds the lady safe and sound in trust, for I'm a rival. Until we clearly testify, by sword or pistol, by and by, which gentlemen prefers to die. And which prefers survival?
If I should die and he should live, to you without reserve I give her heart so young and sensitive, and all her predilections.
If he should live and I should die, I see no kind of reason why you should not, if you wish, and try to gain her young affections.
If I should die and he should
live, and I should die, I see no kind of reason
why you should not,
if I wish, and try to gain her young affections.
Yes, I should die, and you should live, this young man is certainly not so consistent, and given all the great affections.
If you should live, and I should die, see no kind of reason why I should not, if I wish, if I wish, try to gain your young affections.
No happy intervention. A well-constructed plot, a well-constructed plot. When sages try to part two loving hearts in fusion, their wisdoms are delusion, and learning serves them not, and learning serves them not. Until quite plain is their intent, the sages twain I represent. But please infer that nothing loth, nor henceforth as it were engaged to marry both, then take it that I represent the two. On that hypothesis, what would you do?
What would I do? What would I do? In such a case, upon your breast, my blushing face, demurely say, I find this breastplate bright is sorely in the way.
For mortal race is never best, there's no such place as perfect rest. Some petty blight asserts his sway. Come from the rose-leaf light is always in the way.
In such a
case, never blessed, there's no such place as perfect rest.
On your breast, on your breast, is
my daughter, at last we are alone.
Yes, and I'm glad we are, for I've been meaning to speak with you very seriously. Do you know this paper?
Yes, I've seen it. Where in the world did you get it from?
It was given to me by Lady Sophie, my sister's governess.
Lady Sophie is an angel.
But I do sometimes wish she'd mind her own business.
It's rather humorous, don't you think?
I see nothing humorous in it. I only see that you, the despotic king of this country, are made to suffer the most scandalous insinuations. Why do you permit these things?
Well, they appeal to my sense of humor. It's the only really comic newspaper in Utopia, and, well, I wouldn't be without it for the world.
If it had any literary merit, I could understand it, but...
Oh, it has literary merit. Oh, distinctly, it has literary merit.
My dear father, it's mere ungrammatical twaddle.
It is not ungrammatical. Now, I can't allow that. Unpleasantly personal, perhaps. But written with an epigrammatical point that is very rare nowadays. Very rare indeed.
Why do they represent you with such a big nose?
What?
Yes, it is a big one. Why, the fact is that in the cartoons of a comic paper, the size of your nose always varies inversely as the square of your popularity. It's the rule.
Then you must be at a tremendous discount just now. And you allow this buffoon to caricature you in a pointless burlesque? My dear father, if you were a free agent, you would never permit such outrages.
Zara, I admit I am not altogether a free agent. I am controlled. Nominally a despot, I am, between ourselves, the helpless tool of two unscrupulous wise men who insist upon my falling in with all their wishes and threaten to denounce me for immediate explosion if I remonstrate.
Oh, my poor father. Now, listen to me. With a view to remodeling the political and social institutions of Utopia, I have brought with me six representatives of the principal causes that have tended to make England the powerful, happy, and blameless country which the general consensus of European civilization has determined it to be. Place yourself unreservedly in the hands of these men, and they will reorganize your country on a footing that will enable you to defy your persecutors. They are all now washing their hands after their journey. Shall I introduce them?
Oh, my darling daughter, how can I ever thank you? I will, of course, agree to anything that will release me from the abominable tyranny of these two men. What ho! Without there, summon my court without an instant's delay.
When with Englishmen, we're little better than.
Have dealt
with Maxim gun and Nordenfelt, or we'll win the occasion calls. If sailor like you play your cards, unbend your sails and lower your yards, unstep your masts, you'll never want a war. The home you no longer hearts of oak, yet we can steer and we can stoke, and thanks to coal and thanks to coke, we never run a ship ashore.
What, never?
No, never.
What, never?
Hardly ever.
Hardly ever run a ship ashore. Then, if creatures and creatures walk on the star, who never runs a ship ashore. Then, if creatures and creatures walk.
Certain in this veil of sorrow, saving that one's liability is limited. Do you suppose this signifies perdition? If so, you're but a monetary dance. You merely file a winding up petition and start another company at once. Oh, a Russian you may be in your own capacity as a company, you come to utter sorrow. But the liquidators say, never mind, you need an end. So you start another company tomorrow.
But the liquidators say, never mind, you need an end. So you start another company tomorrow.
Well, at first sight, it strikes us as dishonest, but if it's good enough for virtuous England, the first commercial country in the world, it's good enough for us.
You best take care. Please recollect we have not been consulted.
And do I understand you that Great Britain, upon this joint stock principle, is governed?
We haven't come to that exactly, but we're heading rapidly in that direction. The date's not distant.
We shall be before you. We'll go down to posterity, renowned as the first sovereign in Christendom, who registered his crown and country under the Joint Stock Companies Act of 62. Henceforward of a verity, with famous as we link, we'll go down to posterity of sovereigns all the pink.
If you the matter merity, our wishes thus to blink, you'll go down to posterity much earlier than you think.
You'll go up to posterity if I inflict the blow.
You'll go down to posterity, we think we ought to know.
You'll go up, blown up with dynamite.
You'll go up,
of course he will, you're right, up, 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 up.
You
yet not mocking maid, by girlhood choice, the fervor of my love affects my voice. A tenor sings above, this doesn't admit of a question, should keep himself quiet, attend to his diet, and carefully nurse his digestion. But when he is manly enough, he's certain to tell on his singing. You can't do chromatics or proper emphatics, the anguish of bosom is ringing. When distracted with worries and plenty, and his horses are 120, and his fluttering bosom the slave of mistrust is, a tenor can't do himself justice. Now observe. You see, I can't do myself justice. I could sing if my fervor were mock. It's easy enough if you're acting. But when one's emotion is born of devotion, one mustn't be over-exacting. One ought to be firm as a rock, to venture a shaking vibrato. When fervor's expected, be cool and collected, or never a tint or disotto. But of course, when his tongue is of leather, and his lips are pasted together, and his sensitive palate as dry as a crust is, a tenor can't do himself justice. Now observe. You see, I can't do myself justice.
Of heart are all that can be desired, the higher notes of voice are matters of comparative insignificance. Who thinks slightingly of the coconut because it's husky? Besides, you're not singing for an engagement. You have that already.
How good and wise you are. How unerringly your practice brain winnows the wheat from the chaff, the material from the merely incidental.
My Girton training, Arthur. At Girton, all is wheat, and idle chaff is never heard within its walls. But tell me, is not all working marvelously well? Have not our flowers of progress more than justified their name?
We have indeed done our best. Captain Corcoran and I. Have thoroughly remodeled the sister services upon so sound a basis that the South Pacific trembles at the name of Utopia.
How clever of you.
Clever? Not a bit. It's easy as possible when the Admiralty and Horse Guards aren't there to interfere. And so with the others. Freed from the trammels imposed upon them by the idle acts of Parliament, all are given their natural talents foreplay and introduced reforms which even in England would have dreamt of.
But perhaps the most beneficent change of all has been enacted by Mr. Goldberry.
Mr. Goldberry?
Who has applied the limited liability principle to individuals. And every man, woman, and child is now a company limited, with liability restricted to the amount of his declared capital. There's not a christened baby in Utopia who has not already issued his little prospectus.
Marvelous is a civilization which can transmute by a word a limited income into an income limited.
Reform has not stopped here. It has been applied even to the costume of our people. Discarding their own barbaric dress, the natives of our land have adopted the tasteful fashions of England in all their rich entirety. Scafio and Fantis have under undertaken a contract to supply the whole of Utopia with clothing designed upon the most approved English models. And the first drawing room under the new state of things is to be held here this evening.
But drawing rooms are always held in the afternoon.
Ah, we've improved upon that. We all look so much better by candlelight.
Then we must part?
Necessarily, for a time.
Just as I was about to tell you, with all the passionate enthusiasm of my nature, how deeply, how devotedly I love you.
Hush! Are these the accents of a heart that truly feels? True love does not indulge in declamation. Its voice is sweet and soft and low. The west wind whispers when he woos the poplar.
Story in a whisper bitterly.
To a monarch who has been accustomed to the uncontrolled use of his limbs, the costume of a British aristocrat is perhaps at first a bit cramping.
Are you sure this is all right? It's not a practical joke, is it?
No one has a keener sense of humor than I, but the first statutory cabinet council of Utopia Limited must be conducted with dignity and impressiveness. Now, where are the other five who signed the Articles of Association?
Sir, here they are.
Ah, gentlemen,
Our daughter holds her first drawing room in half an hour, and we shall have time to make our half-yearly reports in the interval. I am necessarily unfamiliar with the forms of an English cabinet council. Perhaps the Lord Chamberlain would kindly put us in the way of doing the thing properly and with due regard to the solemnity of the occasion.
Certainly, nothing simpler. His Majesty will, of course, preside.
Like this?
Like this.
We take your word for it that this is all right.
You're not making fun of us, are you?
Well, it seems odd, but never mind.
Society has quite forsaken all her wicked courses, which empties our police courts and abolishes divorces.
Divorce is nearly obsolete in England.
No tolerance is shown to one deserving rank and splendor, for the higher his position is, the greater the offender.
That's a maxim that is prevalent in England.
No peeress at our drawing room before the presence passes who wouldn't be accepted by the lower middle classes. Each shady dame, whatever be her rank, is bowed out neatly.
In short, this happy country has been anglicized completely, completely, completely. It really is surprising what a thorough anglicizing we have brought about. Utopia is quite another land. In her enterprising moment, she is England with improvements which she dutifully offered to our motherland.
Our cities we have beautified, we've done it willy-nilly. And all that is at Belgrave Square is Strand and Piccadilly.
We haven't any slummeries in England.
We've solved the labor question with discrimination polished. So poverty is obsolete and hunger is abolished.
We are going to abolish it in England.
The Chamberlain, our native stage, has purged beyond the question of risky situation and indelicate suggestion. No peace is tolerated if it's costumed indiscreetly.
In short, this happy country has been anglicized completely, completely, completely.
It really is surprising what a thorough anglicizing we have brought about. Utopia is quite another land. In her enterprising movement, she is England with improvements which we dutifully offer to our motherland.
It really is surprising what a thorough anglicizing we have brought about. Utopia is quite another land. In her enterprising movement, she is England with improvements which we dutifully offer to our motherland. Hey!
For our first drawing room. Oh, where are the princesses?
What an extraordinary thing it is that since European looking glasses have been supplied to the royal bedrooms, my daughters are invariably late.
Sir, their royal highnesses await your pleasure in the anteroom.
Oh, well then request them to do us the pleasure to enter at once.
Thank you.
about to commence a very solemn ceremonial, so no giggling, please.
Now, my Lord Chamberlain, we are ready.
Then, ladies and gentlemen, if you please, places, if you please, His Majesty will take his place and will be so obliging as to embrace all the debutantes.
What? Must I really?
Absolutely indispensable.
More jam for the palace people. Now, is everyone in his place?
Everyone is in his place.
Then let the revels commence.
Thank you.
Introduced by the flowers of progress. All are harmless schemes for making an accommodation for our old age are ruined. Our matrimonial agency is at a standstill.
Yeah.
Our cheap sherry business is in bankruptcy.
Yeah.
Our army clothing contracts are paralyzed.
Yeah.
And our society paper, the palace paper, is practically defunct.
Defunct?
Defunct? Is that so? Dear, dear. Oh, I'm truly sorry.
He's truly sorry. Are you aware that Sir Bailey Bulkley has proposed a law of libel by which all the editors of scurrilous newspapers are rounded up and publicly flogged, as in England? Puh! And six of our editors have resigned in succession. Now, the editor of a scurrilous newspaper can stand a great deal. He takes a private thrashing as a matter of course. It's considered in his salary. But no gentleman likes to be publicly flogged.
Yeah!
Naturally. I shouldn't like it myself.
He shouldn't like it himself. Then our burlesque theater is absolutely ruined.
Ruined!
Well, theatrical property is not what it was.
Theatrical property is not what it was. Are you aware that the Lord Chamberlain, who has his own ideas as to how best to elevate the national drama, has declined to license any play that is not in blank verse and 300 years old, as in England?
And if that's not bad enough, your county councillor has ordered a 4-foot wall to be built up right across the presidium in case of fire, as in England.
It's so hard on the company, who are liable to be roasted alive, and this has to be met by enormously increased salaries,
as in England. You're probably aware that we've contracted to supply the entire nation with a complete English outfit. But what you don't know is that when we send in our contracts, all our customers come back pleading liability limited to a declared capital of 18 pence and apply to be dealt with under the Winding Up Act, as in England.
Really, gentlemen, really, this is most irregular. Now, if you would be so good as to formulate a detailed list of your grievances in writing, addressed to the Secretary of Utopia Limited, they will be laid before the board in due course at its next monthly meeting.
you understand that we are defied?
That is the idea I intended to convey.
Defied? We are defied? Take care. You know our power. Trifle with us, and you die!
Die.
If you think that when banded in unity, we may both be defied with impunity, you are sadly misled of a verity. If you value the repose and tranquility, you'll revert to a state of docility, or prepare to regret your temerity.
If my speech is unduly refractory, you may find it a course satisfactory at an early board meeting to show it up. Though in proper excuse you can trumpany, you may wind up a limited company. You cannot conveniently blow it up. Is there a chance to baffle you? I also dance a step or two of this now guess the hidden sense. Of this now guess the hidden sense. Complete indifference.
Of course it does, of course it does. It means complete indifference.
Indifference, indifference, indifference.
As we the dance for every move, the part and all, we will conclude what this may mean. You all may guess, it typifies remorselessness, remorselessness, remorselessness.
It means unruffled cheerfulness,
remorselessness, 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 it typifies cheerfulness.
He's no longer a human being, he's a corporation.
And so long as he confines himself to his articles of association, we can't touch him. Scafio, what are we to do?
Do? Why, raise a revolution. Repeal the Act of 62. Reconvert him into an individual and insist upon his immediate explosion. Durara, just the man we wanted to see.
Certainly, allow me. That's rude.
And we have no time for idle forms. Do you wish to succeed to the throne?
Naturally.
Well, you won't unless you join us.
The king has defied us. And as matters stand, we are helpless.
So are you. We have to come up with some sort of a plot to bring the people about his ears.
A plot? Yes, a plot of superhuman subtlety. Have you such a thing about you?
No, I think not, no. There's one on my dressing table.
No, we don't have time for that. We have to put something into execution and put it into execution without delay. There's not a moment to spare.
With Wiley Gray upon the spot, a private plot we'll plan. The most ingenious private plot since private plots began. That's understood, so far we've got, and striking while the iron's hot, we'll now determine like a shot the details of his private plot.
Such posh I never heard.
How utterly dashed absurd. Why, what put that in your head?
Oh, take him away to bed.
Oh, put him to bed.
Oh, put him to bed.
What put me to bed?
Yes, certainly put him to bed.
So far we haven't quite solved the plot. There aren't a very ingenious lot. But don't be unhappy, it's still on the tappy. We'll presently hit on a capital plot.
Now,
Now there, I think you're right.
That's true, we certainly might.
We will if we possibly can.
Bravo, a capital plan.
That's exceedingly neat and new.
Exceedingly new and neat. I fancy that that will do.
It's certainly very complete.
Well done, you sly old sap. Bravo, you cunning old roll.
You very ingenious chap.
You intellectual, intellectual soul.
You very ingenious chap. You very ingenious, ingenious, ingenious chap. At last, a capital plan we've got. We won't say how and we won't say what. It's safe in my noddle, now off we will toddle and slyly develop this capital plot. And think of the capital plan we've got. We won't say how and we won't say what. It's safe in my noddle, now off we will toddle and slyly develop this capital plot.
First South Pacific drawing room, allowing for a slight difficulty with the trains and a little want for familiarity with the use of the rouge pot. It was, on the whole, a meritorious affair.
My dear Dromoly, it redounds infinitely to your credit.
One or two judicious innovations, I think.
Admirable. The cup of tea and the plate of mixed biscuits were a cheap and effective inspiration.
Yes, my idea entirely. Never been done before.
Pretty little maids, the king's youngest daughters, but timid.
That'll wear off. Young.
That'll wear off. Ha! Oh, here they come, by George. And without the dragon. What can they have done with her?
Oh, if you please. Lady Sophie has sent us in here because Zara and Captain Fitz Battleaxe are going on in the garden in which a manner no well-conducted young ladies ought to witness.
Indeed. We are very much obliged to her ladyship.
Are you? I wonder why. Don't tell us if it's rude.
Rude? Not at all. We are obliged to Lady Sophie because she has afforded us the pleasure of seeing you.
I don't think you ought to talk to us like that. It's calculated to turn our heads. Attractive girls can't be too particular. Oh, pray, pray do not take advantage of our unprotected innocence.
Pray, be reassured. You are in no danger whatever. We're English.
But may I ask, is this extreme delicacy, this shrinking sensitiveness, a general characteristic of utopian young ladies?
Oh, no. We are crack specimens. We are the pick of the basket. Would you mind not coming quite so near? Thank you. And please don't look at us like that. It unsettles us. And we don't like it. We have had the inestimable privilege of being educated by a most refined and easily shocked English lady on the very strictest English principles.
But, my dear young lady...
Oh, don't! You mustn't! It's too affectionate. It really does unsettle us.
Are you really under the impression that English girls are so ridiculously demure? Why, an English girl of the highest type is the best, the most beautiful, the bravest and the brightest creature that heaven has conferred upon this world of ours. She is frank, open-hearted, and fearless, and never shows in so favorable a light as when she gives her own blameless impulses full play.
Oh, you shocking story!
Not at all. I'm speaking the strict truth. We shall tell you about her. How wonderful joy our eyes to bless in her magnificent comeliness is an English girl of 11 stone tall and 5 foot 10 in foot dancing shoe. She follows the hounds and on she pounds the field tails up and the musty midge. Over the hedges and broad she bounds, straight as a crow from vine to village.
occasional maiden over Prague. Go search the world and search the sea, then come you home and sing with me. There's no such gold and no such pearl as a bright and beautiful English girl.
With a tay and mild spin, she stretches her limbs. She golfs, she punts, she rows, she swims. She sings, she plays, she dances too. From 10 or 11 till all is blue. At ball or drum, till small hours come, chaperone's fan conceals her yawning. She'll waltz away like a teetotum and never go home till daylight's dawning. Lawn tennis may share her favors fair, her eyes a dance, her cheeks a glowing. Down comes her hair, but what does she care? It's all her own and it's worth the showing. Ah, go search the world and search the sea, then come you home and sing with me. There's no such gold and no such pearl as a bright and beautiful English girl. Her soul as sweet as the ocean air, for broader he knows no haven there. To find mock modesty, please apply to the conscious blush and the downcast eye. Rich in the things contentment brings, in every poor enjoyment wealthy. Blithe as a beautiful bird she sings, for body and mind are hale and healthy. Her eyes they thrill with bright goodwill, her heart is light as a floating feather, as pure and bright as a mountain rill that leaps and laughs in the highland heather. Oh, go search the world and search the sea, then come you home and sing with me. There's no such gold and no such pearl as a bright and beautiful English girl.
Then I may sing and play,
and
I may laugh and shout.
No, don't.
These maxims you'll endorse.
Of course.
You won't exclaim or fight.
But
I may sing and play, and I may laugh and shout. You won't exclaim or fight.
Whatever you are, be that. Whatever you say, be true. Straightforwardly act, be honest in fact. Be nobody else but you.
Give every answer pat, your character true unfurl. And when it is ripe, then you'll be a type of a capital English girl.
Oh, sweet surprise, a dear delight to find it undisputed quite. All muskets, rusty, roast is might, that art is wrong and nature right. Oh, sweet surprise, a dear delight to find it undisputed quite. All musty, fusty, roast is might, that art is wrong and nature right.
Oh, ow!
Surprise, a dear delight to find it undisputed quite. All must
spotless monarchs I became an advertiser, but all in vain I searched each land so kingless, to my native strand returned a little older and a good deal wiser. I learned that spotless king and prince have disappeared some ages since in paramounts angelic grace. Is but a mask on nature's face.
Thank you.
eager gland, at our enforced command, reformers laid our hand like some remorseless orcus, and made us darkly rue the deed she dared to do, and all is owing to the sated flowers of progress.
So down with them, down with them,
reforms are hated ogress.
So down with them, down with them,
down with flowers of progress.
Civilians will govern your army.
Oh, no.
There will be interminable confusion in the Navy.
Oh, no.
There shall be sickness aplenty.
Oh. Endless lawsuits. Oh. Overcrowded jails.
Oh.
And in short, general and unexampled prosperity for all.
Ulalika! Ulalika! Ulalika!
Election campaigning begin. From now on, the two-party system is adopted with all its attendant blessings. And henceforward, Utopia will no longer be a monarchy limited, but what is a great deal better, a limited monarchy!
There's a little group of isles beyond the wave, so tiny you might almost wonder where it is. That nation is the bravest of the brave, and cowards are the rarest of all rarities. The greatest nations kneel at her command. She terrifies all foreign-born rapscallions.
Such a peace is the